Welcome to the Global War Watch Network. All right, get this. China has just built a supercomputer that works like a human brain. But here's the kicker. It's the size of a refrigerator and uses just a fraction of the power. So the huge question is this it? Is this the moment China officially pulls ahead of the US in the AI race? That's what we're going to unpack today. We're going to look at what this machine, the BIE-1, really is, how in the world it works, and what it can mean for, well, for everything. Okay, so to really get what the BIE-1 is all about, you kind of have to throw out your whole idea of what a supercomputer is. We're not just talking about a small step forward here. No, this is a total rethink of what high-performance computing even looks like. So on the one hand, you've got your traditional supercomputer, right? These things are absolute monsters. They take up an entire room, they need basically their own power plant to run, and they're locked away in these massive data centers. But then you have the BIE-1. It's tiny, it's incredibly efficient, and you can pretty much plug it in anywhere. It's a total game changer. And you don't have to take my word for it. Niale, who's one of the lead researchers on this project, puts it perfectly. We are talking about taking supercomputer-level power out of the specialized data center and putting it, well, anywhere. In offices, in labs, maybe even in a truck or a drone. Just think about that for a second. The possibilities that opens up, they're just huge. So the big question is, how on earth do they cram all that power into such a small box? Well, the secret isn't just about making smaller parts. It's about a totally different approach, a really, really smart way of looking at how computers think. Okay, so at the core of this whole thing is something they're calling an intuitive neural network, or INN. Now, your typical computer is like a robot following a strict to-do list, right? Step one, step two, step three. But the INN, it's designed to work more like a human brain. It connects the dots, it spots patterns, and it learns in a way that's much more flexible. You could almost say it's intuitive. So what's the payoff for this brain-like design? Well, for one, it doesn't need insane amounts of data to learn something new. That's a huge problem for today's AI. It can also figure stuff out on its own. And here's the really cool part. It can handle text, speech, and images all at the same time, simultaneously. The result is performance that you'd usually need a whole room full of expensive, power-guzzling GPUs to even get close to. So all that theory is really fascinating, right? But it's the numbers, the actual performance specs, that make you sit up and take notice. This is where you see just how much of a leap forward this thing really is. Okay. Check this out, 90% lower energy consumption. That is just staggering. Let that sink in for a moment. To put it in perspective, some of these big traditional data centers use more power than entire cities. So the BIE-1 isn't just about saving money on the electric bill. It makes this kind of powerful AI way more sustainable and available to way more people. And what about speed? Well, let's talk tokens per second. You can just think of a token as a piece of a word. For training, that's when it's learning new stuff, it hits 100,000. Pretty good. But for inference, that's when it's actually using what it's learned to do a task, it hits a jaw-dropping 500,000 tokens per second. I mean, those are numbers you'd expect to see from a massive data center, not a machine you can wheel into your office. So when you mix that kind of raw power with that kind of go-anywhere design, what do you get? Well, the possibilities just explode. You could be looking at real-time health monitors in people's homes, AI tutors that are actually personalized to each student, super smart assistants for your office, even gear for scientists to analyze data right there in the middle of a jungle or on a boat. It's a whole new ballgame. But you know, a breakthrough like this is never just about the tech itself. You have to zoom out and look at the bigger picture. And the bigger picture here is all about global competition. Let's put it plainly. This machine is a huge step for China in its goal to become completely self-reliant in key technologies. With all the tension around computer chips and fragile supply chains, being able to build your own powerful AI hardware, well, that's not just a nice to have. It's a number one national priority. Yeah, the BIE-1 is a direct response to this whole global chip war. China's been pouring money into different kinds of chip designs for a while now, things like neuromorphic and analog AI. And the strategy here is pretty brilliant, really. They're mixing their own new software ideas with their own homegrown hardware to basically sidestep the whole problem, to create their own path and not depend on anyone else. So where does all this lead? What's the end game for tech like this? Because it's not really about just making a smaller, better supercomputer. It's about changing the very fabric of how and where we use AI.
And again, let's go back to the researcher, Nile. He says the goal is to basically put this kind of power in everyone's hands. By making it small, efficient, and easy to use, the dream is a future where incredible AI isn't just for huge companies and governments. It's just everywhere, all around us.
And really, that leads us to the final fascinating question. I mean, think about it. We went from computers that filled rooms, to desktops, to laptops, and now to the phones in our pockets. Could this be the next big step? A future where having this kind of intelligent computing power is as normal as having a Wi-Fi router in your house. What would that world actually feel like?
Well, that's all the time we have for today. So what do you think? Is the BIE1 the future? We really want to know what's on your mind, so drop your thoughts down in the comments. And hey, if you enjoyed this breakdown, do us a huge favor and hit that like button, share it with a friend, and of course, make sure you're subscribed to the Global War Watch Network. We've also got links to all our social media in the description below, so you can join the conversation there. Thanks so much for watching.